Today, we're going to talk about the biggest difference between good and great developers. And it's not about who can optimize their code the most or who can memorize the most algorithms. It's actually way more simple. Good developers, they try to write code that works. But great developers, they try to write code that other developers will actually want to use. In this video, I'm going to show you how to take code that works and turn into simple Pythonic code that developers would actually be excited to use. By the end, you'll know 5 easy ways to take advantage of Python's language features to write efficient, easy to understand Pythonic code. Let's say that you need to pull in data from a third-party data provider. Your team? They don't know how to implement it, so you're gonna have to figure it out. But when you're done, you're gonna have some example code that the rest of your team can use, and it'll be enough so that they can make a whole lot of features from it. Sounds good, right? So how do you do it? Well, I think any developer can eventually wade through enough documentation that they can make something that works, like this. We import some dependencies and set up a client to pull down some data. After trying to connect, we just make sure that the connection worked, but if it failed, we gracefully log the failure and warn our users that the data source is offline for now. But if it did work, we iterate over the available data streams and update our dashboards. Oh, we always remember to shut down our client after we're done, because bad things happen if we don't. Not too complicated, right? I mean, it covers all the edge cases we have to worry about. It's a bit ugly, but it works. But what if you were given this instead? It's so much simpler and less error-prone. It's more Pythonic. There's just one problem. The code doesn't work. There is no data provider library. We have yield data provider, but it could exist, right? I mean, we could adapt yield data provider to look and behave more like data provider. Well, if we did that, then we'd be using the adapter design pattern from object-oriented programming. How's that sound? Sound good? Let's do it. To start, I really hate when libraries make users perform magic incantations just to use the library. I mean, look at this. Every time a user creates a client, they have to always remember to close the client when they're done. In Python, we have a language feature that makes it really easy to deal with repetitive setup and teardown logic. It's called a context manager. In context managers, some stuff happens when you enter the context, and some more stuff happens when you exit the context. We can make a class a context manager just by adding 2 methods, enter and exit. These are 2 of Python's many magic methods. Magic methods are Python's way of letting us as developers create rich classes that interoperate with Python's features, operators, functions, and general other keywords and syntax and stuff. You can spot these methods because they start and end with double underscores. Double underscores are typically said as dunder, so if you hear someone say dunder, that's what they mean. The dunder enter method controls what happens when we enter the context. Here we create an instance of the ye old client, and we store it within our new client. Similarly, the exit method controls what happens when we exit the context. Unlike enter, exit has some arguments that affect its behavior. These arguments are exception type, exception value, and the exception traceback. If there's an exception, these will have the values that you might expect from the argument names. But if there's no exception, they'll just be none valued. Here we check to see if a connection error was raised. And if it was, we log it and we tell the users that the data isn't available. Finally, before we exit the context, whether or not an exception was raised, we always close the client. Adding this context manager was already a step in the right direction, but we still have quite a bit more to do. Look how nice it is to just iterate over the streams directly. In the old code, we'd have to use a bunch of getter methods and the range object and iterate over streams by index. That's too much work. First, to make it so that we don't have to use a weird getter to get the streams, let's create a property. We can use the property decorator to decorate our streams method, but then because we use the property decorator, we can access it as if it were a property instead of a method, that is, without parentheses. Inside our implementation, we get the ye old stream manager and we wrap it in our new stream manager adapter class. We'll do the rest of the work there. But wait, what does the stream manager do again? It, It has two methods, get number of streams and get stream by index. And collectively, these are used to iterate over the available streams. Get number of streams is a little weird. I mean, Python already has a perfectly nice way of getting the size of something. It's called the len function. If we implement the dunder-len method, then we could use the len function to get the number of streams from our object. Oh, and this is pretty weird too. Everywhere else in Python, people use square brackets to get things by index, like in lists and tuples and things like that. Why are we using this weird method to get our stream by index? It'd be a lot simpler if we implemented dunder-getItem. Then we can define what happens when someone uses square brackets with our object. Inside our implementation, we use getStreamByIndex to get the particular stream that we need, but we again wrap it in our new StreamAdapter class because we're not done simplifying things yet. But before we get to that, by implementing dunder-len and dunder-getItem, we've actually done something really good for ourselves. We've made our object iterable. We can now iterate directly over the stream manager. This is much better. And some more good news, we're pretty much done. In our old code, we would use getter methods to get name or get data from the stream, but we've already seen how to deal with that. If we use the property decorator, we can turn those getter methods into properties and make our code much cleaner. And that's it. By just implementing a few classes and methods, we could turn our code, which previously looked like this, into something as clean and as simple as this. Here are the five things that you need to look for in your code after this video. Number one, use context managers for handling repetitive setup and teardown logic. Number two, use magic methods. In this code, we used getItem, len, enter, and exit. But there's a whole lot of magic methods that are super useful and they can make your code look like it's part of the built-in library. Number three, use properties instead of getter methods. It's shorter to write and easier to remember for your users. Number four, make things iterable if someone's gonna wanna iterate over it. Don't make them jump through hoops to iterate over stuff. And number five, keep your package structure shallower and easier to import rather than making your users remember deeply nested package structures. No one wants to remember how you laid out your package. If you made it to the end of the video, please like the video. It helps this video reach more people. And if you made it to the end of the video, I'm willing to bet that you want to learn more about magic methods. I did a whole video where I re-implemented the range object in pure Python, and I used a ton of magic methods to accomplish it, like way more than getItem and len. So check that out. We'll be right back.